Okay, and is the defendant Caleb Andrew Kennedy in the detention facility?
Yes, ma'am, he's coming up.
Mr. Kennedy, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, sir, do you understand that this matter is before me today as a motion regarding your bond filed on your behalf by Mr. Beasley?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, and sir, if you desire to talk to Mr. Beasley, I can have him contact you after the hearing, okay? All right.
Yes.
And so I see Mr. Beasley. Mr. Beasley, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And I see the solicitor, Mr. Barnett, is present. Can you hear me? All right. Mr. Beasley, sir, I know that you have filed a motion for bond. And if you don't object, I would like to get a little bit of background from the solicitor regarding the facts and the proceedings up to this point before I hear argument. Do you object to that, sir?
I don't object to that. As long as we're not playing a bunch of videos and stuff, but I'm fine with just the background.
Okay, and then I will let you both argue, Mr. Beasley, as I normally do, but I need the benefit of the background. I know you understand that.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so no argument yet, and then I'll let the solicitor reply to Mr. Beasley's argument in just a moment, okay? All right.
Your Honor, I can't hear Mr. Barnett.
May it please court, Your Honor, this occurred on February the 8th of this year, Your Honor, at 270 West Murph Road here in Spartanburg County, Your Honor. The defendant was driving a 2011 Ford F-150, Your Honor. He had been to a Walmart previously, met a person there, and had told law enforcement afterwards that he had took a hit off a vape pen. After he took the hit off the vape pen, he said that he started tripping, is what he told law enforcement. He was supposed to go to his girlfriend's house, I believe the Union, Your Honor. He went down Southport Road near the PSAF plant, Your Honor. Got lost, went down a road beside of it, then went down 270, down West Murph Road, Your Honor, where there's basically just two houses there. It's a single lane gravel road. As you're going down the road, you come to the first house, you go straight into it, but it turns to the left, and apparently he took the left there. It comes to like a winding road, and it comes down like an arch like this. It comes down to Mr. Parrish's residence, Your Honor, in that case, the victim. And it's a very sharp turn. I've got pictures, Your Honor, that I've handed, I believe, sent to the court, but I'll hand up.
Solicitor, and maybe I wasn't clear. So the underlying charge is for
felony DUI with death, Your Honor.
Felony DUI with death. And the date of incident.
February 8th, 2022, Your Honor.
And this, Mr. Kennedy has been in the detention facility since on or about that time?
That's correct, Your Honor.
Have there been prior motions?
Yes, ma'am.
Explain that to me, please.
There was a prior motion in front of the magistrate, Your Honor, at that time. He denied that motion, Your Honor. A subsequent motion was filed with Judge Ned Miller. Judge Miller heard the motion. Basically ruled that that he'd put or make a pending based off the toxicology reports when they return. There was an emergency bond hearing that was scheduled by the defense, Your Honor, that was heard by Judge Paul from York County, Your Honor. He denied to hear it because the toxicology had not been turned in at that point, Your Honor. He left it pending also. I did receive the toxicology reports. As soon as I received those, I provided those to the defense, and they've scheduled the motion since then, Your Honor.
Okay.
And I apologize. I thought you wanted me to go through the facts of the case.
No, well, and I'm going to let you do that, but I think the procedural history is very important. And so this is as though an initial bond hearing. Is that correct, Mr. Beasley?
Yes, ma'am.
Based upon now, you all do have the information that you needed previously. Is that correct?
At what Judge Miller requested, I provided at the defense yard.
Okay. All right. So now, just if you can give me a very basic recitation of the facts, I'll hear from Mr. Beasley, and then I will come back to you to let you argue regarding bond. And then I will let Mr. Beasley reply if he feels the need to do so. Okay? Okay.
Well,
yes, sir.
I'd with you part of the facts, Your Honor.
Yes, sir.
Continuing down Westmoreland Road, Your Honor, it's a sharp turn. He had obviously made the turn, went into the driveway, Your Honor, and this driveway is 175 yards to a garage area that Mr. Parrish works at. He works on boats, different machineries for different companies. Apparently, he drove down the, and there's boats, and you'll see, well, the picture, I think you saw there's boats and different things that's alongside of it. And Mr. Parrish had just left his house, was on his phone with his best friend, and Mr. Kennedy hit him, ran over top of him, and drove him into the garage. He actually hit him outside the garage, went through the door. The truck rested a heavy piece of machinery at the back of the building. At that time, Mr. Parrish's best friend called his wife, saying that something's happened. Ms. Parrish and her daughter went out to check on him. They found him out there. Mr. Kennedy was with him, holding Mr. Parrish at the time. They called 911, Your Honor, and of course, law enforcement responded. Law enforcement, he made a statement at the scene saying that he'd done the APN from that standpoint, and it started tripping at that point. Later on, law enforcement did go back to the hospital after doing an investigation at the scene. I Mirandized him. I do have the copy of the preliminary hearing that I'll provide to the court, where a trooper warden testified about what he said to them, where he actually prior saw Mr. Parrish prior to hitting him in the driveway in this case. And he was found, he admitted that he was tripping, that and based off the officer's observations, that he was under the influence of marijuana or drugs in that case. Later on, we found out from the defense counsel on the prior motions that he was taking Prozac. There was Prozac bottles found in the truck at a later time. They were prescribed, but he did have it on board from that standpoint. The toxicology shows 0.15 nanograms per milliliter of marijuana, active THC in his system. It does show a 7.5 THC metabolite in that situation with the same measurement. It also showed the Prozac at 66 nanograms per milliliter. I believe that's what it is, y'all.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Beasley, now as to your position, sir, as to bond.
Your Honor, obviously, you know, the main thing we need to consider is whether Caleb's a flight risk or a danger to the community. He is a minor. He's 17 years old. He's never been in trouble. As the state contends, if you take, you know, what the state is alleging, he only took one hit of a vape pen. And according to the tox report, he only has trace amounts of THC. And you know, even according to, you know, law enforcement, they can't determine whether he was impaired from the THC or from the Prozac. So we're obviously going to have some experts help us figure a lot of this out. Caleb was on his way at around lunchtime to go see his girlfriend, and this accident happened. Obviously, this wasn't an intentional act. And one thing that's I think very important, Judge, when you consider Vaughn, is the fact that Caleb remained on the scene, and when EMS arrived, he was holding Mr. Parrish and crying and apologizing profusely. And I can tell you, just my conversations with Caleb over the last 3 months that he's been in jail, all he does is pray for this family and express his sorrow and remorse for what happened. Because he doesn't really know what happened. And you know, if we're watching the video, the scene, I mean, everybody's saying he doesn't know where he is. He doesn't know what's going on. It's a bizarre and tragic accident. He was recently put on Prozac prior to this accident, and he had actually The doctor just doubled his dosage of Prozac because Caleb had been admitted to the ER for some, I think it was an anxiety attack and some chest pain. It's just, it's you know, it's going to take some time to figure out exactly what happened, but it is a terrible accident. And you know, one thing I think the court should, I mean, I was trying to find some similar cases to this one, and I did find a similar case that happened several months ago in Spartanburg, where it was another 17-year-old. But in that case, the 17-year-old was running from the cops at 4 a.m. speeding and actually crashed into another vehicle, killing a 20-year-old girl, Lizette Soto Diaz. In that case, is State versus Jackson Smith. And the judge in that case gave the defendant a $40,000 bond with HIP. So, you know, my contention is that case is a lot more egregious than Caleb's case. And so I think a surety bond, I mean, I think $20,000 is appropriate in this case. Like I said, he stayed on the scene, cooperated with law enforcement. He's not a flight risk. He's never been in trouble. You know, and I don't know if the court is aware of this, and I try not to make it a big issue, but, you know, he was on American Idol last year. He's well known around not only Spartanburg County, but South Carolina and the country. So it's not like he is going to be going anywhere and getting away with anything. You know, spotlight is on him. And, Your Honor, he's still a kid. And like I said, no record. He comes from a great family, and they've been involved from the get-go. He will be living with his mom, but I also would like to probably email the court the address for his dad, too. His parents are divorced. He stays at both houses. But anyway, Judge, I think a low surety bond is appropriate in this case, and that's all I have to say right now.
Mr. Beasley, sir, can we get into more of the specifics regarding bond? You said his father lives, does his dad lives in South Carolina?
Both his parents are in Spartanburg County, Judge.
Okay. Any prior conviction history?
No, Your Honor.
Any financial resources?
Not that I'm aware of, Your Honor.
And he grew up in Spartanburg?
Yes, ma'am.
And you said that he cooperated with law enforcement at the scene. He did not try to fly. He did not try to be a flight risk.
No, Your Honor. He was there with the victim when everyone arrived.
All right. I'm concerned, Mr. Beasley, about one thing, and that would be his mental health. You've mentioned Prozac. Can you tell me a little bit more about that?
So, Your Honor,
who his treating physician is, or was it a family doctor? Was it a mental health provider?
I cannot remember his the doctor's name, but he will continue to get treatment when he gets out. I know that the therapist that he's seeing in the jail actually described what he went through as a dissociative disorder. But I, you know, I'm not a doctor, but I think we need his current doctor that he was seeing to obviously talk to him about. I don't know if he's going to continue him on Prozac or something else, but you know, he's just not getting the care he needs, obviously, in jail, but he can continue to get that. I mean, I'd ask that be a condition of bond that he continue to see his doctor outside, but I don't remember the doctor's name. I can provide that report to
Mr. Beasley. And again, I'm not trying to push too much, but do you know if it was a psychiatrist or his family physician, even a pediatrician, I guess? And if you don't know, that's okay.
I can provide that very quickly, Judge, to the court.
Okay.
In an email with all the information.
Okay, do you know if there has been any type of initial basic mental health assessment during his time in the detention facility? I know that there are certain resources available to inmates there from Spartanburg County Mental Health. And you mentioned, would that be Ms. McAdams that he has been talking to? Do you know?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure her name. I don't have that in front of me either.
But you believe that he has been possibly evaluated while he has been in the detention facility?
I am not sure he's been thoroughly evaluated. You know, I know that, you know, at one point, which concerned us, that they had put him on what they call suicide watch. But that I was, it's my understanding from the, from talking to the jail, that it was just a precautionary thing because of everything just occurred. And it was only a couple of days, and they have no, he's not been on suicide watch since. And everything's been, and he's been doing great. I think they've even maybe taken him off the Prozac, which has made a huge difference. And I can tell you, just personally talk to him, he's a totally different kid, not on the Prozac.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Beasley. I'll come back to you in just a minute, okay? All right. Solicitor?
Thank you, RMA Police Court. I approached Mitch R. for the exhibits I provided earlier, report by email.
Have you provided them to Mr. Beasley?
I have. They're in discovery, plus he's received them in the email that I sent to the court last night with his letters and so forth.
Any objection to that, Mr. Beasley? I did receive documents from you, hand delivery this morning as well. Thank you.
You're welcome. And what is it that he's bringing? I didn't hear.
Photographs.
Oh, that's fine.
These are the 5 photographs, as well as the copy of the preliminary hearing that was done on Monday.
Any objection, Mr. Beasley?
I mean, I'm fine with him handing it up. I'm assuming we're not going to listen to the preliminary hearing.
No, no, sir. If I need to do that, I can do that in chambers.
Okay.
Okay.
No objection.
Yeah, approach, Your Honor.
Yes, sir.
And Your Honor, there's a picture of the Paris family supplied to us, as well as previous court, Your Honor, as well as the picture showing it from the gravel road going into the driveway, going down the driveway to the building where the truck ended up at, Your Honor.
Yes, sir.
Your Honor, the concern that we have, Your Honor, from this standpoint, this is a gentleman that is in his driveway, on his property, well on his property, just going back to work. And, you know, Mr. Kennedy literally ran over top end of the truck in his own driveway. And I think you can tell from what's been said, this bond hearing and everything, there's no question he's under the influence of something. I mean, everybody at the scene, I mean, what he told law enforcement at the scene, as well as the hospital, there is THC on board, as well as the Prozac, Your Honor. There's warnings with Prozac. Obviously, you don't mix that with other drugs from that standpoint, and different things. And that's the danger that we worry about, is that we don't want to put another family in this position. I know the Paris family don't want to see any family in the position they're in right now. So I know Ms. Paris wants to address the court, Your Honor. Let me ask everybody in support of Mr. Paris, please stand up. Thank you all. We also have Mad Mothers here, Kimberly Cockrell with us, where Sarah Coe from the Highway Patrol's office is with us, as well as Sergeant Elrod from the Highway Patrol, Your Honor. I know his parents would like to address the court now, if that'd be fine, Your Honor.
Yes. Please come forward up to the podium. Good morning. If you would state your full name.
Donna Paris.
Yes, ma'am. Take your time.
Your Honor, I would just like to ask the law they denied. Does he kill my husband? So I'm yours. Your Honor, he purposely and consciously decided to put something into his body. He caused him to do this. We didn't know him and he didn't know us. He had no reason to be in our driveway. Nowhere near the road. I know people say innocent until proven guilty, but there was only two people involved in this. And the innocent one is dead. And I hate it. I hate he's sitting where he's sitting. Because if he wasn't, I wouldn't be standing where I'm standing. But Your Honor, he killed my husband at 35 years. I just don't think he deserves one, Your Honor. But I also want to say, I put my trust in the Lord. I know the Lord has a plan for everything. And at a Joyce Meyer conference this weekend, 3-3 conferences, the one thing I brought home, she said, if there's anybody in this conference that has a mess in their life right now, to remember that, turn it over to God, and he can take this mess and make a message. He can make a miracle. I just pray that the Lord will guide everybody through this entire process, and his will be done. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Your Honor. If I have a chance to respond to Mr. Please, if he says anything else, we'd like to be able to do that, Your Honor.
Very briefly, though, okay. And so, but Mr. Barnett, I'm not trying to put words in your mouth, but the state is opposed to bond.
Yes, ma'am.
What is the base?
What is opposed and we're opposed.
What is your basis for being opposed to it? I just need to be clear.
A possible danger to the community from that standpoint, Your Honor, to do something like this in a rural area. I mean, this is out. I couldn't find this place if I had to without a map. I mean, there's just no way from that standpoint. And he is a possible danger to himself. What Mr. Beasley said before about the suicide watch and everything, he is getting treatment at the jail from that standpoint, Your Honor.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Beasley, sir, anything in reply?
Your Honor, again, Caleb, 17 years old, no criminal record. He cooperated at the scene. He's not a flight risk or a danger to the community. And I go back to this other case that was several months ago with another 17-year-old who had a 0.184 blood alcohol judge running from the cops at 4 a.m. And the reason I know about this, because I actually watched the video, and the solicitor was at that bond hearing, and he actually did not object to the bond. He just said that the family objected, and he actually suggested to the conditions of home incarceration for this kid. So I found it very, ironic that he's objecting to a bond on this matter, which is not nearly as egregious as that one. And, Your Honor, I just think, we're here not to decide whether he's guilty or not. It's about whether he's a risk to the community or a flight risk. And he's not.
Okay. And the other matter that you're referring to, Mr. Beasley, I didn't hear that, did I?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Mr. Beasley, a little bit of follow-up concerning Mr. Kennedy's mental health. Any more insight about that?
From my conversations with the jail, that he is fine mentally at this time, and he's been getting treatment on a regular basis, and he's doing well. And he's not on any kind of suicide watch or anything like that. That was just a precautionary thing for 2 days over a month ago. Or 2 months ago, 2 months ago.
And we're not certain, though, if he has been evaluated. Is that correct? I think that's what you said earlier.
He has not been evaluated by, that I'm aware of, in the jail.
Okay.
But we have...
Anything else, Mr. Beasley?
No, Your Honor, but we do have physicians waiting to do everything and evaluate him when he gets out. And he'll continue to see his normal doctor that you've seen prior.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. Beasley? I think the solicitor's got his hand up. He wants to maybe tell me one more thing. If it's something new, I'll come back to you, okay?
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Eric. He's talking about this other bond here from that standpoint. And I can't speak for the judge because obviously the judge said it from that standpoint. It was in the middle of COVID, the second wave of it. And I know this court and other judges have been through the same pressures with COVID situations from that standpoint. The family asked to deny bond just like they did now today. He keeps bringing this incident up. I'm sure if it was heard today, it might be treated totally different.
Solicitor, each case is separate and each set of facts are very different. I understand that.
I understand, but since he brought it up and made the reference he did to me.
Anything else?
I'd rather respond to it. Thank you, ma'am.
Mr. Beasley?
No, Your Honor.
Okay. Well, you all are routinely in front of me, and you know that I'm going to issue my instructions or my order in writing. And maybe I should have addressed that at the beginning, and you all would have been a little bit more at ease during the hearing. I am going to draft either written instructions for the order or the order itself, and that will be forwarded to council via electronic mail from my office. I say this to everyone, both sides, the families involved, and to this young man, the defendant. I know this is extremely important to everyone, and I am going to give this very serious consideration. I want to reflect on it, and I will issue a decision as quickly as I can, hopefully in the next day or two. Okay. And I also want to thank council. They are advocates. They are very strong advocates for their positions, but they are also very professional. And getting ready for a hearing like this is extremely difficult and time consuming. And I commend them on their preparation and on their efficiency today. Thank you all very much. That will conclude the hearing at this time. Good luck to everyone. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Okay.